One of my favorite things that happened to me in the neighborhood, one time I was with a friend and we were, we went to the Uptown, or I think we just wanted to get a drink, and they had like a really loud band playing there that night, so we were like, we don't want to stay here. So we just sort of stepped out and we were standing on the corner of Humboldt and Center, just kind of trying to, you know, figure out what to do next. And this young woman who was on a skateboard wearing a bikini and a lei kind of just sort of happened by, and she said, "Are you looking for some place to go?" And we're like, "Yeah." And she said, "Follow me to Foundation. It's Tiki Tuesday." So we discovered the Foundation, and indeed it was Tiki Tuesday, and they had, it was a great place to just sit and have a conversation. And but I love that this, you know, here was somebody just on a skateboard wearing a, I think she might have been wearing a grass skirt, actually, now that I think about it. But she was, you know, I thought only in Riverwest.
Well, Riverwest has always been a kind of a bohemian village. I think they pride themselves on that. There is a thriving arts community. There are a number of people who live there because of that arts community and because of just kind of a loose lifestyle, a lot of enjoyment of life in general. And it has attracted that kind of counterculture in the city of Milwaukee for a number of years.
It seems like once you pass that border in Riverwest that it becomes a, I don't know how to put it in words, it's a fun place. And it's a place where you're free to be who you are.
When I grow up,
I don't want to live lonely, I don't need to agree, I don't want to live in a neighborhood of facsimiles of me, facsimiles of me.
Where is Milwaukee's Riverwest neighborhood, and how did it get so, well, diverse? Riverwest is a narrow stretch of urban land that borders the Milwaukee River. This stretch of prime real estate was once home to some of Milwaukee's wealthiest families. But before we move back in time, we'd like to introduce you to the diverse groups that have lived in Riverwest in more recent times. The different ethnic groups, subcultures, countercultures, religious sects, social classes, and family and lifestyle groups. But as we will see, integration is more than cultural in Riverwest. Integration here is very complex. It involves people, businesses, organizations, celebrations, and very definitely political and social activism.
Riverwest is the most diverse community in the city that I'm aware of, and I know the city pretty well. I've got friends all over, and I travel regularly and perform around and so forth.
I can remember times when I would walk down the street and hear somebody drive by blasting some Latino salsa music, and then you see somebody with a Puerto Rican flag hanging out of their window, and you know, some black and white and Latino kids come zipping by on a skateboard. And then you might see an old German lady out, you know, sweeping her porch. And it's just a real rich blend.
Although it's been promoted as being hyper-segregated, Riverwest is one of the areas where you actually have people that integrate and intermingle with each other from different nationalities, different cultures, different backgrounds.
There's actually two institutions, and both of them are very important. And one is called the Falcon Bowl, and then the Fraternal Order of Polish Falcons, which still exists, and they own the building, and they have their meetings there, and have at least a yearly celebration of the Polish heritage. Recently I saw a group of young people dressed in traditional Polish costumes, and as far as I can tell, some of those folks were Hmong.
I noticed a different ethnic group at in Riverwest, as Wolof. Wolof are ethnic group from Senegal, which is located in West Africa. You got a Mandingo from Guinea, that also is located in West Africa. And then you have a Susu, and then also you got a Spanish people, and then also you got some kind of Caucasian too. It's kind of very diverse.
There was at least one clown house that we knew of in Riverwest. It was a few blocks from our home and pretty close to the Riverwest Co-op. One of the circus master there volunteered pretty regularly at the co-op, and his name was Eric, but he went by Captain Stupid. The Riverwest Currents ran an article about this particular group called the Brew Circus in October of 2002, and I'll just read a little bit from that article. Proclaimed in flyers as the scariest show on earth, Milwaukee Brew Circus quarters in a Booth Street home known by its inhabitants as the Clown House. There, a front porch spills over with tall bikes used for parades, a backyard harbors a car and van festooned like clowns, an attic and basement brim with puppets, stages, and props.
Probably the most distinctive group that came through regularly for a number of years was the Krusty Punks, whose name came from their commitment to not bathing really at all, and they You'd see men and women with rather stringy long dreadlock hair, and their odor was pretty overpowering, and in upon entering some local businesses would cause a stir occasionally. But so for the most part, they settled and stayed down by the river.
Riverwest's faith communities are as diverse as their people.
As we talk about religion, I think about my age, and I'm in my early 60s now. And growing up in this neighborhood, I saw religion through the Catholic Church.
In those early days, the primary religious focus, it seemed, in the Riverwest neighborhood was St. Casimir's Church, and it was a vibrant community when we first moved here in the early 70s. Again, as the years went by and the population changed, the focus in the neighborhood moved away from the church. People with different ideas, different religious beliefs, some of them quite far out there and artistic in nature, wherein the church itself ended up having to consolidate in order to sustain itself.
Also, you have Muslim people come here, Christians, you know, Buddhist, Asine, and then also Rastafarism. That's a type of religions, you know, exist in Ethiopia, in Jamaica, basically in West Indies.
We get over to Humboldt, and the Friends Meeting House and the Quakers have been such an important asset to our community, especially in terms of its leadership around peace.
I personally practice Tai Chi. And I've been involved in a Buddhist meditation group for decades. And I know I have friends who have Wiccan practices. There are several Catholic churches in the community. Puerto Rican Pentecostal practices is another one that comes to mind. So that's something I find really interesting. Just to be bicycling around and hear the fervor in the church, the Pentecostal church, I mean, that gives me a lift.
I actually lived above a family, a Puerto Rican family, whose mother was a practicing witch. One incident that I do recall, the father of this family actually won quite a bit of money on a lottery game and had decided to take the whole family back to Puerto Rico. To live. Apparently, the mother was opposed to the idea. She had raised her four children in Milwaukee. They had a small business in town, and she really had no intention of wanting to go back. Father was apparently pretty insistent and flew down to Puerto Rico. And as he was driving out of the airport in San Juan, he got into an automobile accident where he was pretty seriously injured. He ended up having to stay in the hospital in Puerto Rico for a couple of weeks and spending all of the money that he had won on the lottery, and then having to come back to Milwaukee, planning to stay. Later on, during a softball game with the son, he had told me that he was pretty convinced it was his mother who had brought about the change in plans, as it were.
Riverwest family types and lifestyle groups are equally diverse.
The amount of diversity in the Riverwest area is phenomenal. We have single families, we have biracial families, extended families, gay or bisexual families.
I think it was intended to be sort of a social and political organization. Some of the things that we've done over the years is we have a picnic every year. That seems to be the most consistent thing that we've done every year. We also have participated in the Gay Pride Parade. One year it was cool. We made like this dragon, like a Chinese dragon. The head of it was built on a shopping cart. It was paper mache. It was really cool. We had a sculptor working with us who was part of the organization. We had a seamstress working with us, another part of the organization. And this dragon was like 50 feet long. It was just beautiful. The head was like breathed fire, and it was real fierce looking and painted in colors of purple and green to sort of represent the river, because we were from Riverwest.
There weren't any rigid requirements for what families looked like or what they were made up of. We had friends that were gay, and we had friends that were blended families. We had family friends that were diverse racially.
A lot of families that have come to Riverwest in recent years, or young people who started families, I think are a little bit outside the box of what you might think of the traditional young family. Riverwest has always, I think, appealed to a little bit more countercultural element. It has a reputation for being a place where a lot of different kinds of people can be comfortable. So I think it tends to attract people who might want to live a little bit differently. I know that we planned a home birth for our third and our fourth daughter, and the woman who was our midwife does a lot of home births in Riverwest.
In Riverwest, even their criminals are diverse.
I know there are drug houses around in the neighborhood still. I used to go on a neighborhood watch, and we'd just drive around and we'd, you know, try to spot what kind of crimes or any suspicious activity. And there's also a lot of problems with landlords, some very neglectful landlords. One landlord was, put in jail twice. This was last year for failure to pay fines regarding all the code violations in his homes.
Riverwest was not always this diverse. In Tom Tolan's comprehensive history of Riverwest, he documents the historic settlements in the area from the early industrial developments on the riverbanks to the defining moments in Riverwest culture in the 60s and 70s and beyond. He discusses the early German workers and aristocrats settled along the river and the Polish Kashubes just to the south. According to Tolan, the Polish neighborhood, or Kompa, was the closest thing you could get in the middle of an American industrial city to a rural Polish village. Most residents kept ducks, geese, and chickens, and a good number had pigs, cows, and goats as well. The long stretch of land west of the Milwaukee River would remain essentially German and Polish until the 1960s. But Tolan and many of the residents interviewed for this documentary suggest that the ancestry of today's neighborhood can be traced back to a series of events in the 1960s and 1970s. During these years, two government programs were displacing major populations in the city. One program was the Urban Renewal Administration, which had been designed to improve central city housing. During the same time period, the Milwaukee County Expressway Commission was building major freeway corridors in the heart of Milwaukee. Among the populations displaced by these programs were African Americans and Puerto Ricans. A major African American community was located just southwest of the Riverwest neighborhood in a dense and culturally rich area called Bronzeville. A major Puerto Rican community had developed just southeast of Riverwest. Residents of both communities were forced to sell their homes or, in some cases, were offered alternative housing in other areas of the city.
30, 40, and even beyond, you know, years ago, they tore down what was a very vibrant black economic community and a center of culture for the highway and for urban renewal. And really, it was like underdeveloping places, just like parts of Africa were underdeveloped.
Gradually, members of both communities found their way into the Riverwest neighborhood. While the resettlement involved some tensions, most of the residents interviewed for this documentary suggested that Riverwest was more welcoming to them than other areas of the city.
I didn't really feel different, so it didn't seem like there were pockets. It just seemed like my mother had friends who were white, she had friends who were Hispanic, she had friends that were Polish. I mean, so it wasn't like I really, there weren't communities, it was one community.
For us, as a Puerto Rican community here in Milwaukee, it meant some hardships, but it also meant some times where we had to come together, and you had organizations formed like the Puerto Rican organization. You had my father that organized the Puerto Rican baseball team. And you had St. Francis Church that began to cater to the Puerto Rican population in terms of the masses. So there are lots of things changing, and changing very fast.
During these years, another population was migrating into Riverwest. These were the counterculturals or hippies of the 60s and early 70s. The hippies had originally settled east of the Milwaukee River, but rising costs of living on the Lower East Side prompted them to cross over to the west bank of the river. The counterculturals were organized around radical reform issues such as cooperative living, social justice, anti-war, and cultural tolerance. Many hippies quickly joined forces with the African Americans, Puerto Ricans, and other liberal-minded European Americans in the Riverwest area over civil rights and fair housing. These alliances set the tone for an enduring reign of activism and tolerance in Riverwest.
Well, I first came to the Riverwest area in about 1973, and I saw then that it was more or less a Polish and Italian neighborhood, and with the beginning of a change near the Holton Street area as more and more African American and Puerto Ricans moved in. At the same time, with that transition, there was an increase in people involved in the arts and in politics, community organization and co-ops. The Outpost Natural Foods, the Gordon Park Food Co-op, what was right next to it on Locust Street, where the green space now is.
Demographically, I would say it changed actually pretty rapidly from a primarily German-Polish older type of demographic to a much younger and much more counterculture type of a neighborhood.
I was living in the East Side, and I came over to Riverwest. I was invited to a party. This was late 60s, early 70s, and I discovered a different neighborhood than what I was living in. It was more blue collar, more open, artistic element. The Bugle, I believe, was published just a few blocks where I ended up living in Riverwest originally.
We were convulsed back then by the racial conflict, or the conflict with the underlying racial aspect. We were children of the parents of the union movements of the 30s and before, which had intense conflict aspects of it. And we were also part of a nation that became absolutely torn right in two by the Vietnam War.
What perhaps contributed the most to the collaboration between African Americans and Puerto Ricans in the Houghton to about 3rd Street area during the 1970s was that Puerto Ricans had lived in that area for a long time, already had an experience with African Americans. They knew they had to work together, and they collaborated on a number of educational, particularly youth programs and in housing programs, because they knew that that area was one that was being populated by both groups, and only through that type of collaboration they could get the city and other officials to help.
The people of Riverwest occupy a variety of jobs, from blue-collar to professional positions. But in Riverwest, art rules. And the art forms are as diverse as the people.
I do drum circles here in the River West. The amount of diversity is amazing. It definitely overfills my cup. We have African American, Latino, Asian American, European American. I mean, it's all different cultures coming together and drumming, doing African drumming, doing Latin drumming.
My teacher said I only need one drum. Well, this is it. This is it. There's a spirit in the tree. He's got something to say. And this is it. This is it. A drum song for our mama on her birthday. And this is it. This is it. There's a reason for these seasons, a rhythm to this rhyme. And this is it.
I did a series of etudes that I called Pipe Bomb, sort of a wordplay, especially at the time this is from 2004, being in a state of war, people doing things with pipe bombs, I just thought it would be kind of fun to do something that was a pun on the idea of a bagpipe and it's a balm for your soul, a musical balm. So here's an example of one of these pieces called Atomic.
Let me speak on my city. The statistics is wicked. If you ain't careful, you get caught in the claws of the law. The system eating our youth, spitting them out raw. Poverty create violence and all the murders you saw. They build jails for poor folks, then tear down the schools. We see your plans, Mr. Mayor. We ain't no fools. Unemployment on the rise. The media lies. Racism just disguised. Hitting close to home. We gotta govern our own and create some hood relief. The whole family gotta teach the seeds. Said proper education always corrects errors. You think things need to change? Start with the man in the mirror. Organize your team and implement your dreams. You've been thinking this for years. Don't have no fear. They can't stop me, so might have to pop me. Can't operate sloppy. I know they want to knock me.
Invasion plans hatched behind White House walls teach us that war is the way to problem solve. Every day and night, the headlines scream, we keep turning our children into killing machines. I had my share of insanity handed to me, and I've passed some on, unfortunately, but I swear a solemn oath. Yes, I give my bond. I'll do my best to break the cycle. From now on, I'll break the vicious cycle.
When you come to my house, please take off your shoes. This is sacred ground on which we stand. This is holy, holy land.
Housing patterns are also diverse in Riverwest, from the narrow lots of Polish flats in the south to the sprawling lots and spacious homes in the northern sections of the neighborhood. Problems with absentee landlords and fears of gentrification along the river have historically raised concerns of residents.
You're dealing with now a group of people that are coming into the neighborhood who don't necessarily look at it as the whole of the neighborhood. They look at it as a piece of the land that they want to be in. They want a piece of this land and not necessarily to be a part of the neighborhood.
Well, I'm a little afraid of gentrification in Riverwest, and because that means the property taxes will rise. Property values will go up, even though, you know, say like somebody bought their house in 1975 for $30,000, suddenly, you know, it's worth $200,000 and they've been on a fixed income for, say, you know, 20 years or something, and they can't necessarily afford the taxes. And I love the diversity that we have here. I love that we have people who are living on pensions, you know, retired people, we have working class people. We have people of all different social classes, and I would hate for it to be all middle class people or all white people, for example.
The counter-cultural ideal of cooperative living has been an enduring practice in Riverwest.
That community spirit of people pitching in and doing things together and sharing resources and looking at things from the perspective of a bigger whole than just their personal little niche is something I really appreciate a lot.
We were married in 1974. We rented an upper flat over on Holton and Our Street, which was at that point primarily a Puerto Rican neighborhood. My first real involvement with the community was in that same year when I joined a small group of people to build and develop the Gordon Park Food Co-op, which was on Locust Street. There had been a grocery store in that place for years, and it was a full-service grocery store that serviced an aging neighborhood. We were open for 10 or 12 years, and in that period of time, it became apparent to everybody involved that the neighborhood had really begun to change. A lot of the older people had died off or had moved out of town or into nursing homes. The population was changing to a much more diverse, somewhat younger groups of people. The food co-op actually became a central point for a lesbian organization in the neighborhood. Of managers at the store for a number of years were active people in the lesbian community.
The Riverwest Co-op, to me, is a kind of miracle in that it's in a fragile market niche. Natural foods are available everywhere now. But the main thing is it builds on this community of Riverwest young people who, for various reasons, want to live in Riverwest because of its mixture of artists and a little bit of everything. But they're totally committed to Riverwest and natural foods. And now, more recently, the Co-op Cafe. This store is definitely a reflection of the counterculture of the 70s.
Riverwest residents delight in their leisure time hours. While parties hold sway, the healthier activities are not ignored. Issues that united the major Riverwest cultural groups back in the 60s and 70s, fair housing, cultural tolerance, peace, and social justice, continue to be championed in the neighborhood. Art is routinely used to advance social causes, and a sense of civic responsibility is often reflected in the art forms.
You know, Riverwest has been known for its progressiveness throughout its development. Here at Peace Action Wisconsin, we're celebrating our 30th anniversary year. And we began around nuclear disarmament, and ironically that becomes an issue today as there's legislation coming down the pike in terms of more nuclear power plants. And as we talk about war, we have to remember the Vietnam Vets Against the War, VVAW, which was founded right here in Milwaukee, National Organization of Returning Vietnam Vets, struggling to end that war. And at the same, many of them are now involved in Veterans for Peace right here, working against the Iraq War.
At the Summer of Peace, we try to educate people early about the causes to why these things happen, and therefore, you know, some of the stuff can be prevented. And we try to instill a certain education into young people so that by the time they're teenagers, and if they still live in Milwaukee, if things are going how they're still going, it's going to be pretty grim for them.
One of my pleasures since working here at Peace Action was getting to see former Mayor Frank Zeidler almost every week. And he was mayor of Milwaukee, as was his brother before him, and he was also presidential candidate. And one who I consider a mentor, because I first got exposed to him when I was in college. But I'll tell you, the socialist democratic history of this area and this state is so important. And right here in Milwaukee, because of that socialism, there was a real feel that you were being represented at City Hall, that people who were elected, you know, worked for the betterment of the people. And just the tradition of the picnic at Kern Park, such a great event. And also, I happen to have the opportunity to walk in and out on some of the Socialist Party meetings here every month at the Peace Action Center.
I learned of the Riverwest neighborhood in the mid-1970s, and through friends of mine who either were students or teachers at UWM. Going out with them or visiting them in that neighborhood, the businesses that seemed to still be on Center Street and Locust Street were the old Ma-Pa type grocery stores, hardware stores. There was a place called the Gordon Cafe that was on Center Street that was a little greasy spoon breakfast and lunch place. And Sometime during the 70s, the shift started to happen with more influxes of young, creative people, and things like the Outpost Natural Foods Co-op started, and as these small mom-pops disappeared, they were replaced by things like co-ops and galleries, and that's really accelerated since that time. In the 1990s, Fuel Cafe appeared, and the whole clientele was a younger, again, creative, maybe not all artists, but people who were interested in that looser lifestyle.
Something that's incredibly important to a community is the Falcon Bowl itself, which has been run by the Okopinskis, who live upstairs, and they actually present an institution that is a way for the community to come together. They also rent the hall to for parties. There's a hall attached and a bowling alley downstairs. So it stood the test of time over many decades, going back into the 50s and up into the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and this new century.
I remember when I was in college, it was a bar on Locust Street called Big Mike's. They had nickel taps. And they were next to the hippie bar, the East Village, and later Hump and Hannah's. There's so much going on. I'll tell you, Lakefront Brewery today is such a big contributor to our community. And in so many places, from the pub to Club Timbuktu with its international fair and community activism.
Timbuktu is the place where gathers all kinds of different social streams, cultural groupings, political tendencies in River West.
And then also Timbuktu is, as I said before, it's a place for everyone. It's an university. School, as you can see, a school is universal. There is no school, is school everywhere.
The beats of the different drummers and explore the uncharted spaces outside of the box.
Most community-based organizations in River West also reflect the diverse cultures and reformist views of the migrants of the 60s and 70s. The groundwork was laid with the development of the East Side Housing Action Committee, or ESHAC. The founders of the now-defunct organization were primarily anti-war activists from the UW-Milwaukee, who had an interest in creating a new kind of community west of the river.
These young ESHAC youth, we called ourselves a new class, because we were quite different from the old working class and the old middle class, the old farming class. We were really sort of like part of this, this incredible global transformation of daily life and the broader institutional matrices within which we act out that daily life. We wanted to carry the torch that the union movement had launched as early as the 1870s and 1880s in Milwaukee. We wanted to carry the torch of the progressive avant-garde yeoman farmers who constituted a major pillar of the La Follette progressive movement in Wisconsin. We knew that we were children of the Milwaukee socialist parties. We read the literature of the socialists. We read the literature of the progressives. We read the literature of the union movements. And we were also children of the anti-war movements that have been part of this nation's fabric.
Those who developed Eshak soon found another cause to rally behind. The cause involved highway policies, and the residents of River West remembered the way highway policies of the past had dislodged communities.
The city was freeway mad at the time and road construction mad, and they were wanting to build connections to the interstate highway, which is to the west of us, and they had chosen Locust Street, and they wanted to widen the street. They actually wanted to widen it all the way to the lakefront. And people in River West were not happy with that and fought it and stopped the condemnation process. And the festival now is a celebration of that community victory to maintain our community by stopping the destruction that would have happened by ramming a very large road through the center of it.
The young Eshakers hit the nail right on the head when they say you do not destroy neighborhood main streets and their businesses and expect there to be a viable, harmonious, productive urban village.
Other organizations, including Healthcare Alternatives, reflect the diversity and progressive concerns of the people of River West.
It's a very active community with a number of different groups, from the music groups to the River West Accordion Club, to the neighborhood groups, to the crime-fighting groups, to the artistic groups. It's a culturally and entertainment-wise a very diverse neighborhood. Music venues that really allow those neighborhood folks to come out and express themselves and to ply their trade.
The River West Investment Co-op was started by a number of people coming from building trades, social work, accounting, finance, law. We're all neighborhood people who were concerned with the prevalence of slumlords, landlords, crime, largely property-related problems due to low owner occupancy in the neighborhood. And in an attempt to improve the housing stock condition, increase owner occupancy, and keep dollars in the neighborhood and to pool community capital, they created the River West Investment Co-op to do those things as a rehab project to buy and resell and buy, repair, and resell properties to new owner occupants.
Rethinking Schools is a pretty unique organization. It started here actually in the River West area. In my house on my kitchen table with an Apple IIe computer and a can of rubber cement. And eventually we moved to the Peace Action Center, which is in the River West up on Keefe Avenue. Now, Rethinking Schools started as a tabloid newspaper around issues of school reform. And our main interest was social justice, anti-racist education, all written and written from the perspective of classroom teachers. And so the school, we see the school really as a community resource. My attitude is the schools should be centers of resistance and renaissance in the community, places where people can have democratic conversation and organize for the betterment of the whole community, not just a narrow school community.
The people of River West find every possible reason to connect. Their forums, networks, and especially celebrations demonstrate the integration of cultural, progressive issues, public art, and alternative practices. Over the years, they've shared their lives over public meetings and potluck dinners.
It was a time when we got together and had these potlucks and we got to know each other, and Kern Park became a meeting place that was for everybody. And our kids remember it because it was easy and fun to be a kid at that point.
More recently, they share their lives over email listservs, a River West Neighborhood Association, various blogs, and a local newspaper.
The Fair Housing Council of Metro Milwaukee liked the kind of issues that I was working on, and I was offered a grant to start the paper. So right away we had a connection towards the integration aspects of this neighborhood. Riverwest has a population of black, white, and Hispanics, young and old, and always has, and somehow we've been able to maintain that mix. So we make a concerted effort to reach out and get the opinions of all those folks.
But it is in the world of celebrations that Riverwest most becomes Riverwest. They honor their cultural backgrounds in sacred ceremonies. They celebrate their patriotism in ways that are uniquely River West.
It's all here, and I think it just makes for a really rich mix, and it's something that you don't see elsewhere in Milwaukee. And I love that all my neighbors aren't exactly like me.
I don't want to live lonely. I don't need to agree. I don't want to live in a neighborhood of facsimiles of me. Facsimiles of me. I wander the streets of River West. I'll study the beats of the different drummers and explore the uncharted spaces outside of the box. I'll feed from plates both holy and profane, to hail the place where I grew into my best and brought honor to the village of my own River West. My own River West.